For so long, the voice of those who are treated has been ignored. It hasn't been listened to, and they've been seen as unreliable witnesses to their own life. It's the only area of medicine I know where you ignore what the patient has experienced.
Welcome to this lecture in our series about new directions in psychiatry. This lecture is a special occasion, and we have Robert Whittaker here, and this is in collaboration with the Danish Voice Hearing Network, and Olga Rønningmann will introduce us to our speaker.
Yes, hello, I'd like to also welcome Robert Whittaker from the States on behalf of the Hearing Voices Network, of which I'm very proud to have been able to bring him over here. His book, Mad in America, changed my life. When I came out of psychiatry, I knew there was something fundamentally wrong, but I didn't know what. And I read that book, and then I read it again, and I looked at all the references, and as I say, I got off the psychiatric motorway. I found an exit sign, and I found a whole world out there. His newest book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, is going to change psychiatry. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Robert Whittaker to Denmark. This is the first time he is here, and won't be the last. Thank you.
I've been traveling a lot in the last couple of years, but it's first time ever in Denmark, so thank you. So I'm a journalist. I've been writing about medicine and science for 20, 25 years. I was a newspaper reporter for a long time covering medicine. For a while, I was the director of publications at Harvard Medical School, very traditional position. And then I also had my own publishing company for a while that focused on the development of new drugs. I had no particular interest in psychiatry. The way I got into this was in 1998. I was co-writing a series for the Boston Globe on abuses of patients in psychiatric research settings. Now, one of the things we did in that series is we wrote about studies in which they had withdrawn people diagnosed with schizophrenia from their antipsychotics. And we said that was an unethical thing to do, because you would never withdraw a diabetic from insulin, so why would you withdraw someone from schizophrenia from a drug that's like insulin for diabetes? What happened though for me when I was doing that series, I came upon some studies by the World Health Organization that challenged that belief system, or what I knew to be true. And the World Health Organization had twice conducted studies that compared outcomes in three poor countries, India, Colombia, and Nigeria, with outcomes in the US and six other, quote, developed countries. And actually, I think Denmark was one of the developed countries in that study. One was a 5-year study, and the other was a 2-year study. And each time, they found that outcomes were much, much better in the developing countries of the world. Much better, in fact, in India and Nigeria than in the US and other developed countries. And the World Health Organization concluded that living in a developed country is, quote, a strong predictor you won't do well long-term if you're diagnosed with schizophrenia. So I wanted to know why. Why are we living in a rich country with our advanced medicine and all the social care we can provide people? Why would that be a predictor you do poorly long-term? Now, if you look at those WHO studies, you'll find this. The first one was a 5-year study. And after it, they were very surprised by their outcomes, and they hypothesized maybe the reason for the better outcomes in the poor countries, in the developing countries, is that the patients were more medication compliant. They took their antipsychotics more regularly. In the second study, they measured medication usage, and they found this. In the poor countries, whereas they used the medications acutely, over the short term, they only maintained a very small percentage of patients on the drugs long term. Only 16% of their patients did they maintain them on long term. Whereas, of course, continual drug use is the standard of care in the US and other rich countries. I understood the medications to be absolutely essential, and yet in this cross-cultural study, the better outcomes were in countries where they used the medications differently, and only a small minority were kept on the drugs long term. Anatomy of an Epidemic was to really look at that question, is how this drug-based paradigm of care is working for us as a society in a larger way. And the common history is this. In 1955, we get a drug called chlorpromazine, and it arrives in asylum medicine in 1955 And this kicks off a psychopharmacological revolution, this great leap forward in care. And this drug is remembered today as the first antipsychotic. Do you hear that language? Antipsychotic, as if it's an antidote specific to psychosis. Like an antibacterial, you know, like penicillin is an antibacterial drug, an antibiotic. It's that same sort of phrase. And then in 1998, the U.S. Surgeon General in the United States, who's the top doctor in our country, wrote a report on mental health, and he says this. Prior to the arrival of Thorazine, we lacked treatments that would prevent people from becoming chronically ill. And then as part of the story of progress, beginning in 1987, we get Prozac on the market. Now this is the first of the second generation antidepressants, said to be better than the first generation. And then we get the atypical antipsychotics, drugs like Zyprexa, Risperdal, they have these names in Denmark.
Yes. Yeah.
And these drugs are said to be better than the old standard antipsychotics. So this is a story of medical progress, of a psychopharmacological revolution, and the drugs getting better, and they fix chemical imbalances in the brain. So what I did as a first step of putting this story of progress under a microscope is just look at the number of people in the United States in need of government care. In other words, they were unable to live by themselves. And this is sort of known as the disabled mentally ill in research terms. So in 1955, there were 360,000 people with a psychiatric diagnosis in mental hospitals at the time. You look at the population, and that's a disability rate of about 213 people per 100,000. This is the moment Thorazine arrives in asylum medicine. Now in the United States, between this time and this time, we deinstitutionalize. We basically empty our state hospitals, and we set up systems of care in the community, basically shelters, and we also set up a Social Security disability program, so someone in the community gets a payment that enables them to live in the community. And what other researchers have said is if you want to track the disabled mentally ill in our society, you now have to look at people on that Social Security disability program due to mental illness. And you find that the number between 1955 and 1987 of the disabled mentally ill grows from 360,000 to 1.25 million adults. That's this era of the first generation drugs. In 1987, our country spent about, the United States spent about $800 million on psychiatric drugs. In 2007, we spent $40 billion. So a 50-fold increase in spending. So you see in the United States, during this modern era, an increase in disability. That's just the numbers. Now, since this book came out, I've been asked to speak in a number of other countries, and as I go to the other countries, I try to look at their disability numbers during this modern era. Here's your data. This is new cases. So you're looking at about 3,000. Now you're up at 9,000. That's a tripling over this last 10 years alone. By the way, you have about 5 million people, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Your rate of disability now, new cases, is much higher than ours is in the United States. This would be like 600,000 in the United States by population, because we have about 300 million. Mm-hmm. And we're getting about 300,000 new cases. So your disability rate is really high. Now, here's this a chapter that's just looking at all the new cases of disability and what percentage are due to mental illness. You'll see you've increased from about 25% to about 50% over the past decade. Now, the disability data doesn't prove anything about the merits of the drugs, one way or the other. But you can see it raises a question for us as a society, right? As we embrace this paradigm of care, embrace the diagnostics in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual put together basically by the APA, is that a belief and a paradigm and a use of the drugs that is reducing the burden of mental illness in our societies? And what you see, it's going the opposite in society after society. The other thing that's interesting is what's really driving the increase is people with depression and bipolar illness. It's actually not the psychotic disorders, it's the affective disorders. This is just a question I think we all need to answer. I believe here in Denmark, aren't you making it harder to get disability as well?
From next year, yes.
Next year?
Yes.
The U.S. is really making it hard to get disability because we can't afford all the people going on disability. Mm. So you can see societies basically have to figure out a paradigm of care that doesn't keep on increasing the disability numbers. And so we're going to have to figure out what's going on. Now, having raised that question, you can see the disability numbers do raise an honest, valid question, and that is this. How do medications shape the long-term course of people's lives? And in terms of their ability to work, their ability to function, their physical health, etc. Now, one of the reasons I think Anatomy of an Epidemic is getting some attention, both in the United States and elsewhere, it's really the first book, even in the United States, to look at the question of how the drugs affect long-term outcomes. Because the reason the drugs get approved by the FDA and basically in other countries is they're shown in clinical trials to knock down the target symptom of a disorder better than placebo over the short term, right? And that is seen as effectiveness. But what is happening to people's lives over the long term is a very different question. And really what I try to do here is look at what science is telling us about how the medications shape lives over the long term. And that's really what's new here. And now the reason I want to do antipsychotic drugs is this tonight. First of all, antipsychotics are seen as at the heart of that psychopharmacological revolution, right? They're the drugs that made it possible to empty the hospitals. Second, they're the best studied class of drugs over the long term, over the past 50 years. And third is this. If there's any class of drugs that should show a clear benefit, it's the antipsychotics. Because we as a society believe if you have a diagnosis of schizophrenia or a diagnosis of a psychotic disorder, you need to be on this drug for life, right? That's the common wisdom. And so if that's so, if we believe in that so fervently, the data here should be really solid showing that the drugs improve the long-term course of schizophrenia. Now imagine you're a researcher in the 1960s. You put people on these antipsychotics. What's your next question? How long should the patient stay on the drugs, right? And what they did is they ran studies designed like this. They took the good responders to antipsychotics, those are the ones where the psychotic symptoms had abated, and then they ran studies where they abruptly withdrew half from the drugs, the other half they maintained on the drugs, and those abruptly withdrawn from the drug relapsed at a higher rate, meaning the psychotic symptoms came back and they had to be rehospitalized at a greater rate. So researchers said, aha, you remove the drug, the disease comes back. Staying on the drug lowers the risk of relapse. You see the reasoning there? Okay, and that is the rationale for long-term use. It's relapse studies, where you abruptly withdraw the drug from half, they relapse at a greater rate. Now, I think there's actually one more part of the evidence base, and it's the doctor's perception. Imagine you're a psychiatrist working in an emergency room. People come in with psychotic symptoms. You give them an antipsychotic. The symptoms abate somewhat over the next 6 weeks. So what do you see? You see that the drug works. Then the person goes home, says, I hate these drugs, goes off, gets rehospitalized, comes back to the hospital. What does the doctor see? Gotta stay on that drug. All right, what's missing from the evidence base? Well, there's a couple things missing. Imagine we ran a study like this. We have people come into an emergency room. Half are put on psychosocial care and are not put on drug, and we're going to follow them for 3 years. The other half are put on drug, we follow them for 3 years. In other words, this is a never exposed group. And we start looking at something more than symptoms. We look at employment. We look at cognitive function. We look at physical health. Do the relapse studies tell us what might happen to people if they weren't put on the drugs? It don't, right? The relapse studies tell you once you're on the drug, don't come off them abruptly. But they don't tell you what might be happening if you treated people with psychosocial care but didn't put them on drugs. The second thing is the relapse studies may have a design flaw. It's the abrupt withdrawal. It's now well known when you, once you're on an antipsychotic, if you abruptly withdraw that drug, it increases the risk of the relapse. But then a person named Ross Baldessarini, he's a famous psychopharmacologist from Harvard University, been doing this for a long time, said, but wait a minute, what sort of relapse rate would we get if we get a gradual withdrawal, try to take the drug away slowly? Now, there were very few studies in the literature where they had tried gradual withdrawal, but he managed to find a few, and in those studies, he found that the relapse rate was only 1/3 as great as it was in the abrupt withdrawal. So that showed partly this high rate of relapses due to the design of the study. And what Rospal Vicerini found is in the gradual trials, withdrawal trials, 38% of the patients relapsed within the first 6 months. But those who did not, he said, had an excellent chance of remaining well indefinitely. So he actually identified like 60% that seemingly could do okay off the medication. Now the final thing in terms of the what's missing from the evidence base is, do clinicians today know what the course of unmedicated schizophrenia is like? Do they see people who are never put on drugs? Do they follow those people long term? They don't, right? So their clinical perception is no longer informed by what we might call the natural course of the disorder. So now you can identify these flaws in the evidence base. Now your next step as a journalist is, okay, are there researchers out there who can say, here are our studies that show we're improving the long-term course, okay? Whatever they might be. And when you do that, you find that the researchers say, we do not have evidence that antipsychotics improve long-term outcomes. Now this was done by Emmanuel Slip. He's a fairly famous psychiatrist from the University of Montreal. He was writing at the 50-year anniversary of the discovery of chlorpromazine, and he says this: after 50 years of these drugs, neuroleptics is another word for antipsychotics, are we able to answer the following simple question? Are these drugs effective in treating schizophrenia? He says, there is no compelling evidence on the matter when long-term is considered. So what this researcher is saying, this is an investigation worth doing, trying to figure out how the drugs affect long-term. You see that? And now here's something I think really important. He says, if we wish to base psychiatry on evidence-based medicine, we run a genuine risk in taking a close look at what has long been considered fact. That's the risk you're all taking here tonight by coming. Because I'm sure in your treatment systems, if you're among general educational programs in psychiatry, they will say these drugs have been shown to be effective. People with schizophrenia need to take these drugs for life, right? That is the standard of care. What he's saying is, maybe that belief isn't well-founded. The next thing I wanted to understand was the Hippocratic Oath. What does the Hippocratic Oath say? We think it says, do no harm, right? Isn't that what it says?
Yes.
What does that mean? Well, if you study Hippocrates, it means something much more than just do no harm. What Hippocrates was saying is there's often a natural capacity to recover in nature from an illness. And what you have to do is you have to improve on that natural capacity to recover, and then if you don't improve on it, you may be doing harm with your intervention. So hypothetically, imagine you have an illness, you treat it, 50% are cured, and the other 50% stay the same. Let's say the natural capacity to recover from this illness is 70% recover and 30% stay the same. And now with your treatment, only 50% recover. You've done harm, right? Now the common understanding is prior to the arrival of drugs, people couldn't get out of the hospital if they were diagnosed with schizophrenia. You remember hearing this? It was always chronic? Not true. When these studies done between 1945 and 1955, roughly two-thirds of the patients would be discharged within 12 to 18 months. When they came back 3 to 5 years later, roughly two-thirds were living independently in the community. Not on social welfare, because we didn't have the social welfare programs. And in 1963, the NIMH did a study where they were looking at employment rates 1 year after initial diagnosis of schizophrenia. And they found that the employment rate was roughly 58%, okay, 1 year after the initial diagnosis. And you know what they said at that time? This is disappointing. This is no better than what we were getting between 1945 to 1955. Now, England did a 5-year study at this time as well. England was diagnosing schizophrenia more narrowly than we did in the United States. And they found this. 5 years after initial diagnosis, one-third just weren't schizophrenic anymore. In other words, they did not have the symptoms of schizophrenia. There was another 20% that was still, they might still be symptomatic, but they could function okay in the community. So employment rates, again, were above 50% 5 years later. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through 50 years of outcomes literature, and I'm going to see every bit of literature, mainstream literature I can find that bears on this question of how the drugs affect long-term outcomes. Now, the first such study was done in the 1960s by the NIMH. It has four arms. People come into an emergency room. Three of the arms are put on a drug. And the reason there's three arms, it's three different antipsychotics, okay? The fourth is placebo. At the end of 6 weeks, the drug-treated patients are doing better. But actually, a lot of the placebo patients are getting better as well. They're then discharged into the community, and then they're followed up a year later. And the researchers noticed something odd. That group treated initially in the hospital with placebo has a lower rehospitalization rate at the end of 1 year than any of the three drug-treated groups. So at this very early moment in the outcomes literature, we see the vaguest hint of a paradox. Drugs that are effective over the short term, could they be increasing the chronicity over the long term? Just the vaguest hint, but it shows this is the very first moment of the long-term outcomes literature. Next, I wanted to look at, well, what did clinicians say about the course of the disorder once they began using antipsychotics at that time? Because physicians in the 50s and 60s would have had some experience seeing what happened to their patients prior to the use of the drugs. And what you see is that the physicians say this, boy, my patients are getting better faster, discharging them. But boy, are they coming back to the hospital in droves. They're really coming back. And they invent this description, the revolving door syndrome, to describe this new course. They go out, they come back. They go out, they come back. This is when you hear this invented. That's one. Number two, they say this. He says, the next thing we're saying is, once you're on drugs, if you relapse, the relapses now are more severe than they used to be. Okay, when no drug is given. And then they notice that if you put patients on drugs, and then they come off, and then they relapse, symptoms tend to persist and intensify. So there's this worry in the clinical perception that the drugs in some ways are actually making a relapse, when relapse occurs, worse. And you can see in the title of this paper that worry. It's titled, Maintenance Antipsychotic Therapy, Is the Cure Worse Than the Disease? In the 1970s, the NIMH revisited the question of the long-term use of these drugs. One of the things they did is they funded a retrospective study by Samuel Bakhoven. He's a psychiatrist at Boston Psychopathic Hospital. Now, he had outcome data, five-year outcome data, from a cohort of first episode patients treated in 1947 with psychosocial care and no drugs. And then he had five-year outcome data from a similar cohort treated in 1967 with drugs plus psychosocial care. What did he find? He found that the relapse rate was higher in the modern cohort, and more importantly was the social functioning. In that 47 cohort, 76% were living successfully in the community 5 years later. He noticed in the 67 cohort, they're now much more socially dependent on welfare, etc. So here's what he concludes. Can you all read this? You can see he's surprised, right? His data is not what he expects it to be. May prolong the social dependency of many discharged patients. That's what he's worried about here. On social functioning, maybe more decreasing their ability to function. Okay, next, by the way, there are very, very, very few studies in the literature where you take first episode patients and you compare psychosocial care to drug over a longer period of time. Very, very few. In first episode patients. This is one of them. The design was, it's 81 patients, I think that's what it is. These are newly diagnosed patients, first episode, and the design is like this. People go into the hospital. They're either put on meds or no meds. This is not placebo controlled. So no meds means in the hospital, they did not get meds. And then, by the way, he's gonna discharge his patients, and he's just gonna follow them for 3 years. So no meds off means they didn't get meds in the hospital and they stayed off for the next 3 years. Antipsychotic off means they got drug in the hospital and then on their own, they went off in the following 3 years. So the 3 year part is just naturalistic. People are free to do whatever they want, okay? And then this is no meds in the hospital. These are people who chose to go on in the 3 year follow up, etc. So what do you see in this data? Of the 41 patients that were treated without meds in the hospital, 24 were able to get through their psychotic episode and never needed to go on the antipsychotics in the 3 years. And it's this never exposed group that has by far the best outcomes. Now, he has a scale severity of illness that actually is measuring social functioning. It goes from 1 to 7. This is a really good outcome, 1.7. That is a really good outcome. And now look at the rehospitalization rate, 8%. How about for the medication compliance group? This is the group that was on drug in the hospital stayed. In terms of functioning, much worse, but they have the highest rehospitalization rate. So here, in this study, you see much greater chronicity in the drug-treated group. So here's what Rappaport says. Again, you can read it yourself. And focus on this, if we're interested in this. This is a different perspective. If we're interested in long-term improvement as opposed to short-term symptom suppression. Now, the next second such study that was done by Lauren Mosher. Lauren Mosher was head of schizophrenia studies in the United States at this time. He was our top schizophrenic doctor. This study was designed like this. People come to an emergency room. They're either randomized into hospital treated with drug, or they're randomized into the experimental arm. If they're randomized into the experimental arm, a small woman named Alma Min comes to the hospital emergency room in a VW bug, picks up the person, and takes them to a house. The drug use in the experimental arm was like this. We will use benzos if necessary right away to restore sleep-wake, but we will try to avoid use of antipsychotics in the initial time. If people aren't doing better after 3-4 weeks, we will put them on antipsychotics, okay? So it's really a delayed use model of drug. So what do they find? The name of the house is Soteria. So they find that at the end of 2 years, those treated experimentally have better outcomes. Okay? And in terms of antipsychotic use, and this again is in this experimental arm, 42% never went on, 39% used them temporarily, and 19% basically needed to be on the drugs long term. What you really see here is a model for selective use, figuring out for whom and for how long, rather than one size fits all. What does Lauren Mosher conclude? You can read it. And once again, there's a sense of a paradox. There's a sense of a surprise. And you can see, it's not harmful, but advantageous. So here's the head schizophrenia doctor says, we may need to rethink the use of these drugs. You see why this is really profound? All drugs have risk-benefit, right? So let's say the benefit is over here, and these are the risks. The risks are the adverse events. The benefit is that you knock down psychosis better than placebo, right? That's why you use the drugs. He's worried that the drugs, rather than decrease psychotic symptoms over the long term, increase them. Anyway, I told you this is the first 25 years, you get this thing, it's the cure worse than the disease. Now at this point, some researchers from McGill University come forth with a hypothesis to explain what they think is happening. Here's how neurons communicate in the brain. You have a presynaptic neuron that releases that chemical messenger, let's say dopamine, a molecule, into this tiny gap between neurons, which we call the synaptic cleft. That molecule then binds with receptors on the receiving neuron, the postsynaptic neuron. We say that molecule fits into the receptors like a key does into a lock. And when that happens, the second neuron gets a message. Now, what they came to understand in the 1970s is that chlorpromazine and these other antipsychotics, what they did is they blocked these receptors. So they sat on these receptors, but they didn't activate this. And because they blocked these receptors, they thwarted the normal transmission of dopaminergic messages. And at a therapeutic dose, chlorpromazine blocks about 70% of a particular type of receptor called the D2 receptor. What they found is, though, the drug, the brain, being extraordinarily plastic, has all these feedback loops in the brain. So the drug blocks dopamine receptors. It's like a brake on dopaminergic transmission. Your brain responds by putting down the accelerator. The presynaptic neuron actually puts out more dopamine than normal for a while. That's one compensatory adaptation. And the receiving neurons try to become more sensitive to the dopamines out there, and they do so by increasing the density of their dopamine receptors. So now, instead of having, say, three or four, obviously this is just, you now have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, did I get that right? 3, 7 receptors. The drug is blocking some, but we've got extra receptors to try to keep the dopaminergic transmission going. This is a well-known phenomenon. The researchers say that the brain is upregulating its receptors, and it's doing so to maintain, they say, its homeostatic equilibrium, the normal functioning of these dopaminergic pathways. And by the way, all the psychiatric drugs basically work this way. If you have a drug like an antidepressant that acts as an accelerator on serotonergic activity, the brain will put down the brake. It'll always do the opposite, okay? But what the researchers, coming back to our story, said is, you get these extra receptors, and the brain now is super sensitive to dopamine. And the idea is, this has two problems. It makes you extra biologically vulnerable to psychosis. You come off the drug, that's why you have the severe relapses. And think about this. The drug puts down the brake, your brain puts down the accelerator, now take away the brake. What do you got? You really have something out of balance, right? They said, that's why we're getting all these severe relapses. But they're also saying, even if you stay on the drug, you have this increased biological vulnerability to psychosis. And you can see, it says, an implication is that the attenuatory or psychotic relapse in a patient has developed such a supersensitivity is determined by more than just the normal course of the illness. Now, there's another worry here, in essence. Have you all heard of tardive dyskinesia? Have you heard of that phrase? So, well, there are three main dopaminergic pathways in the brain. One goes to the basal ganglia, which controls motor movement. One goes to the limbic system, which is involved in emotional responses, and the other goes to the frontal lobes. Now, what they were discovering in this time is people staying on these drugs long-term, many of them were developing tardive dyskinesia, and that's where you get permanent motor dysfunction. And if you go into, say, a long-term shelter, you might notice people doing this. The tongue will be moving rhythmically, or they might have constant other motor movements. Now, that's a sign that the basal ganglia has become dysfunctional, and what's happening is those neurons are firing all the time. So researchers said, well, if you get dysfunction in the basal ganglia, maybe you're going to get dysfunction in the limbic system, and that will lead to tardive psychosis or permanent psychosis. So they looked, they did a study, these are Montreal researchers, and they calculated that after 10 years on the drugs, 30% of their patients showed signs of tardive psychosis, where the psychosis was becoming more severe and more constant. And they say, when this happens, the illness appears worse than ever before, new symptoms of greater severity will appear. So after 25 years, you saw this data that shows we may be increasing the chronicity of the disorder and a biological explanation for why that may be so. Okay? You don't hear much about this anymore. And really what happened was this. There are stories of Guy Chouinard and Barry Jones, they're the ones who came up with this hypothesis, presenting to groups of psychiatrists, and the audience just going, they can't take it. Sort of cognitive dissonance. People standing up saying, are you telling me that the drugs I use to fix psychosis are making me more psychotic over the long term? And you see psychiatry basically push, at least American psychiatry, push this concern away. We're not going to talk about it anymore. So, that was 25 years ago. What we want to see now going forward, we're going to look at whatever evidence we can find, and we're going to see, is there any evidence that maybe the dopamine supersensitivity problem does exist? And then we're going to see what other evidence may be out there that's relevant. Now, one of the things that happens is we get MRI technology in the 1990s, which allows us to study brain volumes, right? Now, if you give antipsychotics to monkeys, healthy monkeys, at a therapeutic dose, in other words, for their body weight, you will find that their brains shrink. And that after 2 years on the drug, their brains weigh about 10% less than normal. And that's with the old drugs and the new drugs. So this is an example of the animal research you see. And you'll see the differences were observed across all major brain regions, but appeared most robust in the frontal and parietal regions. So this raises the question, might it be happening in humans? Nancy Andreasen is the former editor of the American Journal of Psychiatry. So this is someone at the heart of American psychiatry. And in early 1990s, she started a very large MRI study of a mostly first episode schizophrenia. And her theory was this. Schizophrenia is a neurodegenerative disease characterized by brain volume over loss. In other words, it's a disease process. So she's going to do MRIs, and she's going to expect to see the brain shrink over time. But she expects it to be a disease process, okay? Now, she reports in 2003, that's what she's seeing. You see this progressive reduction in frontal white matter volume, etc. She's saying, I discovered the disease, the brain shrink. Then she says, as this happens, what happens to symptoms? You see, they correlate with the worsening of negative symptoms, that's that emotional lethargy, increased functional impairment, and after 5 years, cognitive decline. By the way, you know, I don't really like presenting this data. I think it's really upsetting data. I'm sorry, especially if people are taking the medications. And one thing I always like to say, if you're taking the medications, this is not a medical advice talk. Never act on whatever you hear here. It's just the question is what we as a society might know about the drugs and then discuss, okay? But I really actually hate presenting this data, but I think we need to know it. Anyway, so she's saying, as the shrinkage happens, we get this impairment. But you have an obvious question. Is it the disease or is it the drug? Because if it's happening to the animals, maybe it's the drug. And in 2011, she reported that the shrinkage is indeed drug-related. Use of the old drugs, the new drugs, and clozapine were all associated with smaller brain tissue volumes, decreases in both white and gray matter. Severity of illness and substance abuse had minimal or no effect on brain volumes. Here's, you can read this quote. Here's what she's told the New York Times. How many of you have you heard that the brain causes frontal atrophy? I mean, that the drugs cause frontal atrophy. Atrophy means shrinkage. It causes the prefrontal cortex to slowly atrophy. This is from the former editor of the American Journal of Psychiatry. Now, if Nancy Andreasen were here, she'd say this. I think there's still a disease process going on, where the brain shrinks. Unfortunately, the drugs, rather than arrest that brain shrinkage, exacerbate it. I will tell you, though, there is a researcher in the UK named Joanne Moncrief, and one in the United States is that named Jonathan Leal. They scoured all the MRI studies of schizophrenia patients, and somehow they found three long-term studies where people had never been medicated. I have no idea where they found these patients. In those three studies, they did not find a statistically significant difference in brain volumes between the patients and the normal subjects, which raises the possibility that it's entirely drug. This just came out last month. You'll see, if they look at this, you'll see much more severe brain loss in the medicated patients. Here's why this is so upsetting. Think about this. You have an outside agent is administered to the person. As that happens over time, their brain shrink. There's a morphological change. And as that shrinkage happens, the person becomes more emotionally disengaged, more functionally impaired, and worse cognitive function as well. That's really the story of an iatrogenic process. Iatrogenic meaning treatment cost. So you can see why this is a worrying line of research. Okay, I told you about the WHO cross-cultural studies. We started out with this. You'll see that both times they found that being in a developed country was a strong predictor of not attaining a complete remission. They found exceptionally good social outcomes in the poor countries. They looked at the medication usage. You'll see that it was different. Then they went back to look at the patients, and they noticed in the poor countries where the majority were not maintained as a matter of course, 53% were never psychotic anymore, and 73% were employed. Okay, now those studies were done in the 1970s and 1980s. We have a new cross-cultural study done by Eli Lilly, the maker of olanzapine, Zyprexa. What's different about this study is everybody is kept on drugs for 3 years, so there's no variability in drug usage. It's a huge study. Now, actually, there's a lot of symptom control here. This actually is pretty good outcomes. Okay, you see this one? But here's the question is, How are they functioning in society? Are they working? Are they socially engaged? You see how poor it is? And now, this is sort of the old developing countries, they're worse now than say you are in North Europe. And it isn't that Europe has come up, it's that the poor countries have come down in functional outcomes. So you see, as they adopted our paradigm of care, where you maintain patients, their functional outcomes went down. Okay, one last bit, and then we'll finish this up for questions. We have here what I'd like to call dueling stories. We have a story that we believe in is that the antipsychotics kicked off a psychopharmacological revolution, helped make it possible for people to live in the community, and are so essential for the treatment of schizophrenia, right? Like insulin for diabetes. I told you a different story tonight. I said, let's follow this other science, and that science illuminates a paradox. Over the long term, it seems they make the people more chronically ill and more functionally impaired. Those are dueling stories. Now, there's one long-term study that's been done in the United States, prospective, that really helps us see which of those stories is predictive. Remember, if the conventional wisdom is predictive, if we do a study where we follow people long-term, those who stay on the medication should do better than those who get off, right? If what I've told you is true, if that science is predictive, if the opposite will be true. So here's the study. It was done by Martin Harrell. He's at the University of Illinois College of Medicine. Starting in the late 70s, early 1980s, he enrolls 200 psychotic patients into his study. Okay, and now everybody is treated, it's a naturalistic study. Everybody is treated conventionally in the hospital with drugs. All right? Then they're discharged, and now he's just gonna follow them at 2 years, 4.5 years, 7.5 years, 10 and 15 years, and 20. And in each follow-up, he's gonna look at, are they taking antipsychotic medication? Have they been in the hospital? Are they still having symptoms? Are they working? Are they anxious? What's their cognitive function, okay? At the end of 15 years, he still had 145 of the 200 patients in his study. That is a really good keeping people in your study, 77%. And of the 145, 64 had a diagnosis with schizophrenia, 81 with a diagnosis of a milder disorder. And you see here, it's a young cohort. We're getting them early in the course of this. And about half, it's their first hospitalization, which is good. We're seeing them early on, okay? Here's his results, and I've mixed the results from both his 20 year and his 15 years. This first one is from his 20 years. This one I think is really interesting. Oh, by the way, this is of the 64 schizophrenia patients, 25 had gotten off by year two. This would not happen today, but in the early 1980s, there was more leeway for patients getting off. At the end of 2 years, the percentage of people suffering from high anxiety is about the same. About half the patients have this real high anxiety inside. Notice what happens between year two and 4.5. Those on drug, the number experiencing high anxiety increases. Yeah. Whereas those who go off drug, there's this extraordinary drop in the percentage experiencing high anxiety. Mm. Now, there's no other place in the literature that tells us of a possible healing process from year two to 4.5. Do the relapse studies tell us this? They don't, right? Mm. This is the only place where you see this extended healing happening between year two and 4.5. Now, anxiety, by the way, correlates with outcome. High anxiety is a real predictor of poor outcome. And what probably is happening, the researcher says, is something called tardive akathisia is developing. Mm-hmm. Now, akathisia is this inner agitation where you feel like you can't move, but you want to move.
Yeah.
And it's, people describe it as a form of sort of inner torture. Yeah. Olga was talking, you don't mind, right?
No.
Olga was on antipsychotics for long term. She talks about how this is so acute, this pain. And what they're saying is it seems to be becoming chronic and persistent. Anyway, this is a huge difference. Next, cognitive function. Remember we said the drugs shrink the brain and impair cognition? If that's so, maybe you're going to see better cognition than those who got off. That's what you see at every follow-up. The blue is the off group. Remember we talked about the worry that dopamine supersensitivity would make people more psychotic over the long term? That's what he found. 80% had active psychotic symptoms at the 10-year follow-up versus 23% of those off. You'll see the numbers here. They were much more likely to be still psychotic if they stayed on the drugs. This is just a global adjustment of all the patients who got off. You'll see that again. At year two, there's not much difference. The difference shows up between year two and 4.5. And it's this very time that the anxiety diverges. Okay? Again, you see the healing take place here, and it basically maintains. Recovery rates. In order to be recovered in his study, you had to be asymptomatic at the follow-up, you couldn't have been hospitalized in the previous year, and you had to be working or in school more than 50% of the time. So there's a functional component. Now at the end of 2 years, about 20% of those off meds are in recovery versus like 6% of those on meds. Again, it's between year 2 and 4.5 that the fates diverge, such that by the end of 4.5 years, 40% of those off meds are in recovery versus 5% of those on meds. That's recovery rate stays, that difference stays the same in 15 years. Now Harrell has three outcomes. He has recovered, so-so, uniformly poor. The off group, 40% recovered, this should be 44, not 46, sorry about that, is the so-so, only 16% uniformly poor. Here's the on med group. Only 5% recovered, 46% so-so, 49% uniformly poor. So it's not just a lower recovery rate, much more likely to be in this uniformly poor. Now, if you read the Harrell paper published at the end of 15 years, he says this. It's not that the drugs make people worse. He says there was a group with good prognosis, the drugs stabilized them, and that's what enabled them to go off, and they were the more and more likely to go off. So what you really have here, it's a good prognosis group versus a bad prognosis group. That's what he says in the discussion. But that's not what his data shows. If you look at his good prognosis patients, those who got off did better than those who stayed on. In his bad prognosis group, those who got off did better than those who stayed on. And then we're going to see some more data with the milder psychotic disorders group. It's the same thing. And so I said to Dr. Harrell, that's not what your data shows. Your data shows that every subset, it was the off-med group that did better. So Martin Harrell said to me, listen, this sort of goes off the record. I was told not to publish this data by my colleagues because it was bad for psychiatry. He couldn't get it published in an American journal. And this guy has like 150 publications. He's been doing the longitudinal studies of mental disorders for a long term. His funding was threatened because of these results. What he was telling me, he's spinning this in order to make it acceptable. But here's what he told people at the 2008 meeting. He didn't, this is not from the writing, but this is what he told his colleagues at the 2008 meeting. I conclude, not on antipsychotic medication for a long period of time have significantly better global function than those on antipsychotics. This is the best long-term study we have. It's the only prospective study we have. Now, how many of you have heard this in your studies? It's not part of the information that's given us. How about the other psychotic patients? You'll see again, it's those off do much better. Again, it happens here. By the way, this is really good outcomes. More than like 60% of the people are employed. And here is the study that really belies the idea that it's just good prognosis. It's different prognostic categories. This is milder disorders. Now, these are people who are following accepted wisdom, okay? These are the outcomes for those who follow their doctor's orders. These are the outcomes, and the better outcomes are here, are for those who didn't follow the doctor's orders. Much better. And here's the real kicker. Schizophrenia off is much better than milder disorders on. How does a worse illness, one with a worse prognosis, do better than those with a milder prognosis long term? Now, I only know one explanation. The drugs are iatrogenic. They're worsening in the whole, on the whole, aggregate outcomes. Now, when we say this, this does not mean necessarily that nobody benefits from the drugs, that sort of thing. It just means in the aggregate, you're not improving outcomes. But I would say this, if you want to irritate people, but raise a discussion, just use this graphic. Ask why. How do we explain this? And you can see why we need to explain it. Here's the summary of this finding. Those who stayed on antipsychotics were more psychotic, more anxious, had worse cognitive function, much lower recovery rates, much more likely to have uniformly poor outcome, had worse global outcomes, etc. He also I haven't put a slide up on this. He compared recovery rates, those who had a sustained period of recovery, like for 3 years or more, for those who were medication compliant throughout the 20 years, and the group that got off by drugs in 2 years and stayed off for the next 18 years. Of those who were medication compliant, only 17% ever had one period of sustained recovery. The reason was they weren't working. Among those who got off and stayed off, 87% had two or more sustained periods of recovery. And the difference was they were working. He actually found people that had been diagnosed with schizophrenia became, so one of them became a lawyer, there were some teachers. And what he found was those who got off and did well, they disappeared from the system. They didn't go back to their doctors. And he says, this is the clinical illusion. We don't see those that get off and do well. He raises this question. I think it's an obvious question. Here's what I think, if you put this data together, it's telling us. You would, with for your first episode patients, you would try to avoid initial use of antipsychotics to see that subset with psychosocial care that can get through the psychotic break without going on the drugs, so you wouldn't have this change in the brain. And then if people didn't get better after, say, 3-4 weeks, you put them on the drug, and then you could see who, after a period of time of stabilization, could go off successfully. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And it's sort of a for whom and for how long protocol. It's not an anti-med use. Now, the beauty of this story is that there is a group in northern Finland that you've heard about, open dialogue therapy. That's how they use their medications. And they've been doing that since 1992, and they now have the best outcomes in the Western world. Here's their outcomes. Numbers are fairly small. This is combined data from 2 5-year studies. You'll see 67% of their patients 5 years out have never been exposed to antipsychotics. About a third have been exposed, but only 20% are on them regularly. If you look at the percentage that are asymptomatic at the 5-year follow-up, it's 80%. Employment, only 20% have gone on to long-term disability. You see the other 80% are either in the workforce or in the school. This unemployment rate is actually lower than it is for the Finnish population as a whole. It shows how hard they were working to get people back to work. So the other thing that's happened in Western Lapland is that schizophrenia is disappearing in Western Lapland. So it's a population of about 70,000 people. In the 1970s, 1980s, they were getting about 27 new cases of schizophrenia per year, which is a lot for a population of 70,000. They're now down to 2 to 3 cases. But the eruption of psychosis in their society has not changed. The number of first episode psychotic breaks is about the same as it was. The difference is people aren't staying psychotic long enough with this. They do a lot of psychosocial care up front and use the drugs in this way. To get a diagnosis of schizophrenia, you have to be psychotic 6 months or more. They're not staying psychotic long enough to move on to that diagnosis. Now, this is from the British Journal of Psychiatry. And this came out of a National Institute of Clinical Excellence. That's their advisory group that advises the National Health Service. They've been reviewing some of this long-term outcomes data. Now, when I gave this talk 3 years ago, it made you seem like you were one of the wild cry from the distant outback. But things are changing. And here's what they said. And this is mainstream, okay? This is coming from people engaged with the National Institute of Clinical Excellence. It's time to reappraise our use of these drugs. And they say this is not a wild cry from the distant outback, but a considered opinion by influential researchers at NICE. This is the National Institute of Clinical Excellence. There is an increasing body of evidence, and we're talking about Harold here, that the adverse effects of antipsychotic treatment are, to put it simply, not worth the candle. This is pretty profound. Okay, because we believe so solidly in these drugs, and what I'm telling you is this reappraisal is coming from an evidence-based point of view. And then we'll do this. I could tell something of a similar story for antidepressants. You see that antidepressants, if you follow them, they've changed the course of the disorder from an episodic disorder to a much more chronic course. If we look at manic depressive illness, same sort of thing, much less episodic to a much more chronic course. And you'll see, so for example, people worried now, are the drugs depressogenic over the long term? Saying that maybe they cause tardive dysphoria over the long term, that's talking about antidepressants. You'll look at, with bipolar, there's two things. When you put people on antidepressants, you increase the risk that the unipolar person will convert to bipolar. So one of the reasons we have this extraordinary surge in bipolar is because it increases the risk you'll have a manic episode and go bipolar. This is data quantifying that risk, showing the greater risk if you treat it with drug. Here's a quote saying from Fred Goodwin, is a former director of the National Institute of Mental Health. He writes the textbooks on manic depressive illness. He says, if you create iatrogenically with the drug a bipolar patient, that patient's likely to have recurrences even if any antidepressant is discontinued. Evidence shows like that in other words. So this is literature from mainstream researchers saying we are creating bipolar patients with the antidepressants. Anyway, and just these are three leading bipolar experts in the country talking about the change in outcomes in bipolar. If you read each one, Carlos Arrate's head of the mood disorders program, he wrote a paper in 2000 saying we used to get good outcomes for manic depressive illness. Now we're having bad outcomes. Ross Baldessarini, same thing. Used to be favorable, now poor functional outcomes. Fred Goodwin saying the illness has been altered. So you see and hear the sense that things are going awry. And here's the final quote. Again, British Journal of Psychiatry. Remember we began this talk about this psychopharmacological revolution, this belief in this great advance in care? What is the journal saying? They're saying it's time to put that belief aside. That revolution really hasn't panned out. And we need a new paradigm of care. And what they're really saying is we need a much more holistic paradigm of care that has a lot of emphasis on psychosocial care. And then we figure out over here the drugs for whom and for how long, which is very different than one size fits all. And that the drugs fix insulin for diabetes. And again, what is important for me is, you didn't hear this 3 years ago. In fact, when I wrote this book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, there was a review in my hometown newspaper, the Boston Globe, that came out the day the morning the book was produced. It was hit the shelves. It was written by a doctor, a child sleep specialist who works at Children's Hospital. He's not a psychiatrist. He'd never written a review ever. And here's what he said. He likened me to an AIDS denier. And he likened me to a South African dictator by raising these issues had caused hundreds of thousands of deaths. Now, I will say, when you write a book, you don't really want to be likened to an AIDS denier. That's not the great thing to wake up to. But here we are 2.5 years later. And really, the British Journal of Psychiatry is saying the same thing. It's time to rethink this paradigm of care. And I think what's happening is if we look at what is happening with societies, the disability rates up and up. We have an early death problem with severe mental illness. And when we look at long-term outcomes, you just do not see evidence that the drugs, on the whole, improve long-term outcomes when we look at employment, social functioning, that sort of thing. And I want to emphasize one thing. We're talking about in the whole, in the aggregate. I know some people who function really well on these meds. I wish everybody functioned really well on the meds. So we're not saying that this is what happens to everybody. It's just what is happening to outcomes in the aggregate. Okay? Thanks. And then we'll have questions, I think, after the break.
Peter Gutsch at the Nordic Cochrane Centre in Copenhagen, and it has been incredibly well documented that this idea of treating depressed patients for years is wrong. When they stop the drug industry tells the psychiatrist that it's a disease that has come back, which it is not. It's dependent symptoms, we know that very well, and it's the same for antipsychotic drugs. And not so surprising, given how they work. So the drug industry has actually created these terrible epidemics. There's no doubt about that. And what I would like to ask you is that we mostly do it in randomized trials in Cochrane, as you know.
Right.
And I know that there are thousands of studies in schizophrenia, randomized trials. So I would be surprised if there were not trials comparing low and high doses or an antipsychotic versus psychotherapy. I know there are such trials. So shouldn't it be possible to collect these trials and then see if there are long-term follow-ups in order to substantiate what you have told us here today?
I know there are some studies that have compared dosage levels, but I don't know any randomized studies of the sort you're talking about that really go beyond a year, random ones. I just don't think they're out there. And the problem is, there's two problems is, I don't really think the divergence really happens until later. You know, in other words, it's the deleterious effects of being on antipsychotics, I think they show up further down the road. So I actually don't know of randomized studies that last 2-5 years. I think it's hard to do that ethically to keep people randomized.
No, it's very simple.
Okay.
It's ethical to do a trial like that. Your own mental, National Institute of Mental Health should do a trial like that.
Oh, I agree with that. You're sort of going to the point, is there a real hole in the evidence base for long-term? The answer is there is. Now, what I put here together is the best available evidence I could find for longer-term outcomes to tell a coherent story. But ideally, we would now fund all sorts of research of the sorts you're talking about that really would take into account the fact that these drugs build dependencies, which is you're talking about, and so that once you're on, coming off is difficult, et cetera. And we would look at slow tapering and we would look at all this. But we don't have it. I think 50 years into this revolution, it's time to get it. Don't you think?
Yeah.
You said there were some researches which prove that brains actually shrink after taking antipsychotic and maybe also the other. And it's very funny because in Denmark, every time when the psychiatrists want to prove that it is a genetic disease and biological disease, they always say we can prove it on the brains. We have a lot of brains and a big collection of brains in Denmark, and we can you can see on the brains that they have a disease.
Well, what do they see?
Yeah.
Exactly. No, I'm asking you what they're
saying. Yeah, but I don't know what they're saying. Maybe you had heard about it.
Now, early on, they would do these studies in people on drug, and they would say whatever changes they saw are due to the disease.
Exactly, yeah.
But obviously, you have to control for the drug. Mm-hmm. And then they would start doing medication, what they said were naive patients. Yeah. And they say, okay, if they're medication naive, then we know it's due to the disease or not, right? Yeah. But if you actually look into that, a lot of the studies said to be medication naive, they're not medication naive. They were on the drug, say, like for 3 months. And they said, well, that can't possibly have happened to anything. Well, actually, the shrinking starts to happen pretty quickly.
Exactly.
But we have this whole dialogue as if schizophrenia is a discrete disorder. And there's a new paper out by Thomas Insel, who's the head of the NIMH. He says, really, this is bad. This is leading us astray, because clearly we should be talking about the group of schizophrenias. Might be a lot of different things going on, and this is why we might have a lot of different reactions to the drugs and a lot of different outcomes as well. So this is coming from the highest part of the NIMH, and what he says about the DSM is this. It's really surprising. This paper just came out. We still do not have data that shows the validity of these disorders. What I'm saying to you is this. We get all these pronouncements. Schizophrenia has these brain problems, etc. And the whole discussion is screwed up. Because it's assuming something that's a discrete disorder that just isn't shown in science. Mm-hmm. And there's all this mixing between what is schizophrenia, psychosis. Do you know, if you go back to where Emil Kraepelin, who's the great German psychiatrist, he looks at his psychotic patients, right? And he says that psychotic patients that present with a lot of, with affect, you know, either depressed or manic, etc., those psychotic patients tend to have good long-term outcomes. Schizophrenia was psychotic patients that showed a lack of affect. Okay, it was a subset of psychotic patients. And actually they had, if you go back to the Kraepelin data, a lot of them had trouble making willed movements. And probably a lot of people in his initial cohort had encephalized lethargica. There was a viral disease that hit Europe in the late 1800s, early 1900s called encephalitis lethargica. Okay? And actually, there was a lot of confusion at that time in diagnosis between encephalitis lethargica, Parkinson's disease, and schizophrenia. And in all of them, they had sort of this trouble-making willed movements. There was a lot of withdrawal from the world. And then once they identified the virus, I think it was in 1916, Now they can identify encephalitis lethargically. Once they start removing those patients from the schizophrenia pool, the schizophrenia diagnosis begins to be applied to a different cohort of patients. So it's a concept born in confusion, in my opinion.
We've had this whole period since June of over-medication here in Denmark. There's been quite a bit of silence from psychiatry, but now they have had an article in a national newspaper by four psychiatrists, prominent psychiatrists, and they refer to a Finnish study on that people actually survive better on drugs than they do off their drugs. I was wondering if you perhaps could say something on that one.
Listen, there is data, again from Finland, that was reported that the more drug you're on, the greater risk for mortality of antipsychotic. Number two is, we know that antipsychotics cause problems with blood sugars, triglyceride levels, all sorts of metabolic problems, obesity. All of those are risk factors for early death. What they're saying is these people are living longer on this side, okay? And so if you're on this side, this is good. And they say, look at this. People who are on drugs 5 to 7 years, they're living longer than those on no drug. You see that? Okay, and this is what they're citing. Now, if you ask Finnish researchers, they'll say, we have no idea how they got this. Because there just isn't a lot of people that are never exposed to drugs. And what the researchers did is they looked at the Finnish database. They have a drug registry and a patient, say, identification number. And so let's say a patient identification number 156, and they look at 156 if they ever filled a prescription, and they don't show it. But what they'll say is they don't think this drug registry is any good. That's what the Finnish doctors just say. But here's the more important thing is, you see this group that has the best survival rate? They're on antipsychotic drugs 0 to 5 years in the 11 years. So actually the best survival rate is in the group that got off the drugs. But what the researchers are quoting is, they're comparing this to no medication, and they're conveniently leaving out the people who got off in the course of 6 months. And I hate to say this, but it's dishonest. And what happened was, so I was a reviewer, and initially when the study came in, they had a deal like, let's say someone's on drugs for 25 years, they go off drugs for 2 weeks and they die. Let's say their kidneys are failing. They were attributing initially that death to a no-med group, even though they had been on for 25 years. And the background to this is this. The United States did a study and they found that the seriously mentally ill were dying 25 years earlier than normal. And this really upset people, right? And there was a lot of pressure for someone to come up with the opposite story. And this is the study that came out. And I will tell you that the Finnish researchers who did this, they had some connections to the drug companies. It wasn't funded by the drug companies, but they had some connections. Anyway, the problem is, this study is being cited everywhere now as proof that the drugs are good, that they extend life, okay? No one actually gets to see this chart. But I hate to say it, when your doctor in Finland quotes that, they should have the decency to point this out.
I have been in the system for almost 20 years and I'm 48 now. In the early age, I found out that when I got fear, when I got anger, it was inside me. And schizophrenic is something that they put on me about 8 or 10 years ago. And I didn't know what to do about it because psychiatrists, they have a lot of opinion, they know a lot, they have the knowledge, but they don't always ask in the right way. Mm-hmm. How still I could talk about something that they can't help me with. And I have decided to use my anger and to tell what I most fear. And what I mostly fear is to be strong, to be fighting and be a part of the society, because it's like a filter. It's like seeking to longing for peace and for longing for quiet places and for longing to reach out.
One of the things that is changing, I think, at least in the United States, and I think it's changing in Denmark and throughout Europe, is for so long the voice of those who are treated has been ignored. It hasn't been listened to, and they've been seen as unreliable witnesses to their own life. You know, it's the only area of medicine I know where you ignore what the patient has experienced. And I think one of the things that is happening now, which is such a welcome development, is that maybe if you're going to practice good medicine, is you have to listen to the person who's being treated and honor their experience and see it as valid. So the point is, I hope that in the future we'll honor the voice of those who are being treated much more. What are they going through? What are their life stories like? We really need to, I think, rediscover in medicine life stories, especially in psychiatry. How did people reach this place? And it just didn't come out of nowhere, right? There's a story that leads up to these things. And I think we need to rediscover that. And so hopefully this is happening.
After having been at hospital in 2 months, and I went back to high school, I could no longer understand letters and numbers. It would break down economically if the Denmark should pay for all the damages psychiatry has done during the years. Tardive to near and so on. Problems with the heart and much more.
The last thing you said was you have tardive dyskinesia and tardive dystonia, which are known side effects of long-term use of antipsychotic medications. And you know, unfortunately, it's a sign that you know you've had some damage to your basal ganglia. So you know, it's just sort of bearing witness to one of the adverse effects we talked about here today. Mm-hmm.
You told me that you your book was going to be translated into Danish. Well, this is a way to recommend the book then. Yeah, and finally I would say that I'm not a researcher but a clinical working in a psychiatric hospital. I've done that for 7 years, and my personal experience unfortunately supports your data. But I've seen lots of patients, been talking with lots of professionals in the system, and unfortunately the personal experience from the patients are not that important these days. So hopefully your book will make it possible to use this very important experiences from the professionals and patients. Yeah, that's it.
I will say, nonprofit foundation called the Foundation for Excellence in Mental Health Care. They put together a scientific advisory board. They've raised about $3 million. They want to raise $200 million to fund research really into long-term outcomes. But they're already now funding 2 open dialogue replication projects around the drawing board in Western Massachusetts. They're funding Martin Harrell. I told you that someone was asking about the baseline data for Martin Harrell. The foundation actually is funding him to do that, to further dig into these subsets and really give us the data for each subset. They're funding some research out of the Massachusetts General Hospital devoted to looking at what's happening to kids on medications long term. There's a couple states now that have funded soteria projects based on this. Vermont just set up a new home where they're withdrawing people from medications. And my point of this is this. I hope you saw that this was, as much as possible, a review of the evidence out there. A review of the mainstream evidence. This is not coming from left field, or you know, people don't believe in the biological model actually. And that once people confront this evidence, some people will be willing to try things different because they do see it as evidence-based. Those 2 open dialogue projects that are going to happen, they're going to use the medications, I think, in the way they do in northern Western Lapland. This will be the first time in 30 years that first episode psychotic patients aren't immediately put on antipsychotics. And the only way they can get that ethical approval through an institutional review board, because these have a ties to academic institutions, is they have to convince those institutional review boards is that this is a ethical, evidence-based thing to do. There's a rationale for it. And initially the IRBs were quite hostile to this idea, but now they're changing when they've had a chance to review the evidence. So my point is, if you get this book translated into Denmark and you can start this discussion and you can make this evidence known, you know, you might be able to institute change.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.